हेलो। वेलकम बैक माय डियर स्टूडेंट्स, दिस इज रोशन नायक फ्रॉम वास्टेक चैनल। टुडे विल कंटिन्यू द फोर्थ मॉड्यूल ऑफ एमपी एंड एमसी 17CS44 ऑफ यूटीयू सिलेबस फॉर फोर सेमेस्टर सीएस एंड आईएस स्टूडेंट। टुडे वी विल सी द डेटा फ्लो मॉडल ऑफ एआरएम। द क्वेश्चन इज इन द एग्जाम इज द क्वेश्चन मे बी इन द एग्जाम इज लाइक डेटा फ्लो मॉडल ऑफ द एआरएम or the architecture of ARM processor. So the data flow model indicates how the data flow inside the flow of data inside the processor, how the data is processed inside the processor. This indicates the data flow model. So you can see here the different functional units of data flow model: instruction decoder, sign extender, register file, barrel shifter, ALU, MAC, address register, incrementer. So you should know for any processor, the execution is a fetch. It will try to fetch, it will first fetch the instruction, decode and execute. For fetching instruction, it need memory address. So who gives the memory address? In our case, program counter, PC indicates the next PC gives the address of the next instruction to be executed, right? Yeah. So we have in ARM 15 register, R0 to R15. All these are usable register. Actually 37 registers are there. We'll come to know later, but in that R0 to R15 is a visible register. In that 15th register is called as a PC, program counter. So now 15th register, program counter sends the signal to address, to fetch the address to the memory. So think like memory somewhere here at the top of the this diagram. From there, instruction is fetched based on the address given by the PC. Now this instruction contains both data as well as the instruction contains both data and instruction. Let me repeat, program counter, 15th register is the program counter which sends a signal to the memory. Suppose here if I write, this is the memory, here data and instruction both are there. From particular address sent by the program counter, particular instructions is fetched. That instructions comes from the memory to here. Here the data instruction contain both data and the instruction. Data is separated. Instruction is sent to instruction decoder. Instruction means, for example, move. That is the opcode that indicates what action to be taken on the operand, right? That is decoded by the instruction decoder here, and that will pass the signal to various unit. Here it is not shown. That will pass the signal to various unit what action to be taken. Now data comes to sign extender. You may have question, what is sign extender? As I said earlier in my earlier video, ARM will ARM contains 32-bit register, but still it process 8-bit data, 16-bit data and 32-bit data. Suppose the 8-bit data comes, the data to be extended to 32-bit. For example, 8-bit data is like 8-bit data, I will write here 8-bit data 14. This will, to represent this, it takes 8-bit. Now this should be extended, it should be made to 32-bit. So it is extended to make 32-bit and stored here in the register file. That is called a sign extend. But you may ask, sign extend? So yeah, Now the question comes, in the data, there are positive data, like I can store plus 14, I can store minus 14. That time, whether you are going to add 0 or whether you are going to add 1 depends on the sign bit. We have seen sign bit extension in 8086, same concepts apply here. What I want to tell you is we are not going to add only 0, we are going to add 1 also, depends on the sign of the number. That's why it is called as sign extend. So the data is stored in the register file. From the register file, one operand goes to ALU, other operand goes to barrel shifter. You will come to know what is barrel shifter later, but barrel shifter will improve the performance. It has got certain operation, left shifting, right shifting. By that way, it will take one operand in advance. It will do the operation and pass that result to the ALU. It will improve the performance. The output of ALU is moved to register, one of the register, and the result is stored in the register. You see here, the processing is done in the register and the result is stored in the register. So that is a speciality of ARM. Other than that, it has got multiply and accumulate, one more unit. So it will help in multiplication of very big numbers. So it will take one register and it will store multiplication of that. Whenever multiplication has to be performed, it will do that multiplication, and that is stored in the register. So this is called as multiply and accumulate. After this, address is incremented. You know, once the particular instruction is executed, it has to go to the next instruction. That is done by the incrementer to the address register, and once again the signal is sent to address decoding by the PC. So this is called as ARM data flow model. How the data is flowed data is moved inside the ARM processor. From the exam point of view, very, very important questions. So you have to remember 2 points here. The points are, one thing is, first one is ARM has got ARM processor, like all the RISC processor, it has got load and store architecture. What do you mean by load and store architecture? It has two instructions, load and store, to move the data into the processor and to the move the result to the memory from the processor. That is, load instructions copy the data from memory to the register, and store instruction copy the data from the register to memory. There are no data processing instructions that directly manipulate the data memory. Thus, the data processing is carried out in the register. You can see in the previous diagram here. See, once again, here data comes from the memory. See, this is data comes from the memory, data and instruction, and the result goes to the memory. These two directions you can see, result goes to the memory and the data comes. One is called as a load instruction, other one is called as a store instruction to the memory. Memory is not shown here, to the memory. So next, my dear students, next one is called as programmer model. Explain ARM programmer model. So in the exam, the question may be, explain ARM architecture of the programmer model. So in that, nothing but how the ARM register can be programmed. So this is called as programmer model. So it contains various registers. So we will, first of all, before writing programmer's model architecture, we have to see what are the different types of registers. So in ARM, around 37 registers are available, and you can see at a time 15 registers are there in ARM. It is visible. So those 15 registers are R0 to R12. R13 is called as stack pointer. You know stack pointer point to the stack, top of the stack, and we know what is the purpose of the stack also. And next one is link register, LR. And second one is a program counter. You know program counter will indicate which of the next instruction has to be executed. So LR is a link register. Link register will store the address when the program jump to the subroutine. Link register will store the return address when the program jump to the subroutine. Return address for the execution. So registers are there, around 15 registers you can see here. Other than that, we have one more register. This is called as CPSR, current program status registers. Other than that, we can see it works, ARM works in 7 different modes, and that is called as a protected mode, one protected mode and unprotected mode. One is unprotected mode or privilege mode and non-privileged mode. So one mode is out of 7 mode, one mode is called as user mode. This is called as non-privileged mode, and the rest of the modes are called as privilege mode. You will come to know later. So there are total up to 18 active 32-bit registers, 16 data registers and 2 process status registers. 16 data register in the sense 0 to 15, 16 data registers and 2 process status register. Process status register is CPSR and SPSR. SPSR is not shown here because this mode is normally called as user mode or system mode. In user mode and system mode, SPSR is not available. So you will come to know that later. SPSR, the full form of SPSR is a saved program status register. So first we will complete data flow program, I mean this one, programmer model of ARM architecture. In the programmer model of the, this is called as programmer model of ARM architecture. Here you can see different registers, total 37 registers are available, and you can see here, and these registers are banked according to different mode. So which and all modes are there, we can see now: user and system, past interrupt request, interrupt request, supervisor mode, undefined mode, abort mode. These are the mode used by the mode which ARM moves whenever interrupt is called. So 7 modes are there. In that, one mode is called as user mode, that is non-privileged mode, and rest of the modes are privilege mode. So in user and system mode, these are the registers available. In fast interrupt request mode, these are the registers available. Along with these registers, please remember, along with the register, these are the registers available. For example, R8 register is treated as R8 fast interrupt request. R9 register, here it becomes R9 fast interrupt request. In interrupt request mode, R0 to R12 is available. Other than that, 2 more registers are available here. So supervisor mode, other than these registers, supervisor mode contains R3 supervisor, R14 supervisor, and all these modes you can see SPSR registers are available except our user mode. These registers are called as banked registers. This is used under particular interrupt. So you will come to know all these things later. This is the programmer model of ARM architecture. So bank registers are available only when the processor is in particular mode. For example, abort mode as bank register R13 abort, R14 abort, SPR abort. Bank registers of particular mode are denoted by an underline character first fixed to the mode mnemonic or mode. So now we'll move to current program status register. So ARM uses current program status register to monitor and control internal operation. What is current program status register? Current program status register is a 32-bit register. It is normally used for to indicate the flag operation of the ALU in terms of flag status. So there are five flags are visible. One is zero flag, negative flag, zero flag, carry flag, and overflow flag. First N is negative, Z is zero, C is carry, V is overflow, and one more is there, Q is saturation. So 32-bit registers are divided something like this, flags, status, extension, and control. From our syllabus perspective, we will try to understand first byte and the last byte. In the first byte, it indicates the various processor mode as I explained earlier. Then it will also, fifth bit will also indicates whether the instruction set is thumb state, ARM is operating in thumb state or ARM state. Then seventh and sixth bit indicates interrupt masks. So all these are different fields of current program status register. So flag fields contains conditional flags. We know what do you mean by conditional flag? Conditional flag based on the conditions. Condition flags indicates condition flags will be activated based on the conditions of the previous instruction. For example, the previous instructions results in zero arithmetic operation results in zero. Zero flag is activated. So zero flag is activated based on the previous condition. That is called as condition flags. Previous condition in the condition in the previous instruction. That is called as condition flags. Some AR processors have extra bit. This bit is called as Zazzle enabled J bit. This is called as Zazzle enabled processor, which execute 8-bit instruction. So processor mode. There are two types of modes are there, privilege mode and non-privileged mode. What do you mean by privilege mode? Privilege mode allows full write to read and write access to CPSR. Non-privileged mode allows to access read access to the control field in the CPSR, but still allows read write access to the condition flags. Please remember, non-privileged mode in the exam while writing, you have to write like this only. Privilege mode allows full read-write access to the CPSR, but non-privileged mode allows only read access to the condition field and still allows read-write access to the condition flags. So now, what are the modes? Six privileged modes are there. The processor enters abort mode when there is a failed attempt to access the memory. So what are the six privileged modes? So we will see one by one, so it will help you to understand more easily. These are the six privilege mode as I explained earlier, but first we'll see supervisor mode. What is supervisor mode? For example, I will take mobile. We know mobile makes use of ARM processor, right? When you switch on your mobile, it has to load operating system. Whatever operating system it has got, like Android and other operating system, it has to load that to the memory. To load the operating system, it goes to boot operation. During boot operation, it will try to load the operating system. For loading operating system, it need highest privilege. That privilege is called as a supervisor mode. So supervisor mode is the mode that processor is in after resetting, generally the mode that is operating system kernel operates in. Once the mobile is loaded with the operating system. Now it is called as user mode. User mode, most of the 90% of the time, your mobile remains in the user mode. Suppose you want to install some app. That time, you need certain type. You want to install some app. Means your mobile wants to install some app that is selected by you. That time, it needs some additional privilege. So that additional privilege is given in the system mode. System mode, special version of the user mode that allows to full read-write access to CPSR. So other than that, whenever you press any icon or any application, that time it executes interrupt and it goes to various interrupt mode. First one is the fast interrupt request and interrupt request mode. Corresponding two more interrupts are available in ARM. So why it is called as a fast interrupt? Why it is called as a normal interrupt? Fast interrupt, additional registers are available. So that's why it is faster. Why registers are inside the mobile? Inside the ARM processor. So when registers are inside the ARM processor, processing is faster. So that's why it is called as a fast interrupt mode rather than a normal interrupt mode. Normal interrupt mode, you have seen the programmer model. In a fast interrupt mode, 5 registers, extra registers are available. Let me take you to once there. See this diagram. See, fast interrupt mode, extra 5 registers are available compared to interrupt request mode. So when the extra registers are available and registers are internal to the mobile, ARM, that is faster. That's why it is called as a fast interrupt request mode. So here the interrupt is processed more faster than this normal interrupt mode. So other than that, we have something called as abort mode. When there is a failed attempt to access the memory, abort mode, it goes to abort mode. And undefined mode, when the processor encounters some instruction that is not recognized by the operating system or ARM, then that goes to undefined mode. One non-privileged mode is user mode. User mode is a non-privileged mode. And please remember, 90% of the time, your mobile remains in the home screen, that is called as user mode. So you can see in all mode there is a saved program register. Whenever your ARM goes from user mode to interrupt request mode, it has to store current program status register, so that when it returns back, then it can come to the original settings by referring the CPSR. So when it jumps from user mode to this mode, it will store this CPSR in SPSR IRQ register, so that when it returns from this register to this mode to this original mode, it will take that content once again back so that it can continue in user mode. That is the use of SPSR register. That is saved program status register. But in user mode, there is no CPSR. User mode is the normal. It is the home screen of your mobile. From there, it goes to some other mode. But it is the original point. Here, there is no nothing. Here, it is not required to store SPSR. So when it moves from this mode to the other mode, CPSR is stored in SPSR. So that's why here there is no SPSR, because it is a starting point. Here there is no SPSR. So from the exam point of view, you have to better explain this one, the different modes, abbreviation, privilege or not, and 5 bits you have seen in current program status register, 5 bits 1011, this you have to remember how the bits mode 0 to 4 bit, that is 5 bits, how 5 bits are assigned for different modes. In the exam, you have to write this one. So in the next session, you will see state and instruction sets. Thank you.